In the next few videos, I'm going to demonstrate how a CRBasic program is used in a real-world situation. In this case, I will be taking water level measurements using the CS475A radar water level sensor from Campbell Scientific. Another term for water level is stage, which is the term used by the sensor. My program already has some variables declared. In this video, I will add an SDI-12 stage measurement to the program. I begin by adding a public variable named SDI-12RADAR4. I'm making this variable an array of 4 because the sensor I'm using is a CS475A radar gauge from Campbell Scientific, which outputs 4 measurements: stage, distance, battery voltage, and an error code. Declaring the variable as an array of 4 creates 4 separate variables named SDI-12RADAR1 to SDI-12RADAR4, one variable for each value output by the sensor. I could use this array as is, but I'm likely to forget which output is stored in which variable. To make the outputs easy to identify, I will assign aliases to each of the 4 variables using the alias instruction. I start by putting my cursor where I want to insert the alias, and then I go to the instruction toolbar, click on Alias, and then click Insert at the top of the instruction list. First, I type SDI-12RADAR1 equals stage. Then I copy and paste this 3 times and modify each line so I have alias SDI-12RADAR2 equals distance, alias SDI-12RADAR3 equals radar bat, and alias SDI-12RADAR4 equals radar error code. Now I can refer to these variables by either their original name or their alias throughout the program. I am also able to view the aliases in the public table. Now that I have variables defined to store the sensor outputs, I need to configure a data table to store the outputs to final data storage. To see a list of CRBasic instructions that can be used for data table output and processing, select Data Tables Output Processing from the drop-down list at the top of the instruction window. When I set up a data table, I like to organize it so the primary data, or the data that I bought the data logger to measure, is at the top of the table. So, the first output I add to this data table is a sample of the stage measurement. To do this, I place my cursor where I want the sample instruction to be inserted, and then double-click on Sample in the instruction list. This opens an instruction parameter box that tells me what each parameter of the sample instruction is. I can put my cursor in a parameter value box and then use the F1 button on my keyboard to bring up help for that parameter. I will leave the repetitions parameter at 1 as I'm only interested in recording the stage value. If I wanted to record all 4 values output by the sensor, I could change the repetitions to 4. I can right-click in the source box to bring up a list of variables available to be used in this instruction. Notice this list includes both the original SDI-12 radar variable and the aliases for each variable in this array. In this case, the source is stage, so I will click on stage. I can right-click in the data type box to see a list of data types available. Each of these data types has a different range and resolution. FP2 is a floating point 2-byte number with a maximum value of 7,999. But the resolution, or places to the right of the decimal, is dependent on the magnitude of the number. For example, if the value is less than 8, then the number will have 3 decimal places. If the number is 80 or greater, then the number will only have 1 decimal place. The FP2 data format isn't a good choice. But if I use the IEEE 4 data type, I can report stage values with up to 7 digits of resolution. The trade-off for using IEEE 4 is that this format uses twice as much storage memory as FP2. So don't use high-resolution data points when they're not necessary. In this case, because my stage value could exceed 79 feet and I need 1/100th resolution, I will choose the IEEE 4 data type. Now this data table will store stage, battery voltage, and temperature measurements. But notice that the default template table has a 15-second data interval. I will change the data interval from 15 seconds to 15 minutes. I will also change the scan interval from 1 second to 15 minutes. Now that I have defined the program variables and configured the data table, I will go into the main program section and add a stage measurement. Place the cursor on the line below the battery measurement and add the SDI-12 recorder measurement. Now go over to the instruction list and double-click on the SDI-12 recorder instruction. This opens a parameter window for this instruction. In the destination parameter box, I will right-click to view a list of all the variables in the program. In this case, I will select the SDI-12 radar variable array since the SDI-12 recorder instruction will report all four sensor outputs. Next, I right-click in the SDI port parameter box to see a list of available data logger terminals. In this case, the SDI-12 data line for the sensor is physically wired to terminal C1. So I select C1 for the SDI port. The default SDI-12 address is 0, so I will leave that alone. The default SDI command is M!, which is also fine. I will also leave the multiplier and offset at their default values. Finally, I will save the program and make sure it compiles. It compiles OK, which means I can load this program into the data logger and get 15-minute stage readings. Now I will send the program to the data logger using the Compile, Save, and Send button in the top left corner. I like to use this button in the CRBasic editor because it's convenient to send a program directly from the CRBasic editor. But this should be used with care because if I have unsaved data on the data logger, the data will be erased. If there is any unsaved data on the data logger, make sure to save it before sending a new program to the data logger. An alternative way to send the program is to use the Send Program button on the Connect screen. This may be a safer way to send the program because in this case, I am warned to save any unsaved data. Once the program has compiled, I will go to the Monitor Data tab to view the public table. In the public table, I see the variables from the program which hold the data logger panel temperature and battery voltage, as well as stage, distance, radar battery, and any error code from the radar sensor. Notice that the order of these variables in the public table matches the order they're declared in the CRBasic program. This is why it is important to declare variables in a logical order based on function or grouped by sensor type, or whatever organization scheme helps me find the measurements I'm looking for easily in the public table. I'm satisfied with the order of the public variables, but I notice that the values associated with these variables are not updating. This is because the program is set up to measure and record data on a 15-minute interval. Most of the time, I will not want to wait 15 minutes to view data. So in the next video, I will show how to modify the program to make real-time measurements during a site visit, and then return to a 15-minute interval when I'm done viewing the measurements.